Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Flawless Consulting, a guide to getting your expertise used. Written by Peter Block. Narrated by Erik Synnestvedt. What's new? The last time I revised this book was in 1999, when we're millennium-minded. On the one hand, we feared business would be shutting down, because the computer world was going to abort and refuse to grow 1 year older. On the other side was the belief that the new millennium would mark the beginning of a new consciousness for peace and well-being. Well, neither really happened. Our dependency on computers and technology has only intensified. And a decade into the millennium, we are at war, still addicted to fossil fuels, and concerned whether the economic system we have grown used to is still relevant. This means that living with a vulnerable present and an uncertain future is going to be a permanent condition. This situation bodes well for the world of consulting. The more complexity, confusion, and uncertainty in our lives, the more we realize we cannot go it alone or keep doing what we have been doing. The demand for help and advice should keep growing. The profound uncertainty of our lives, both personally and at work, also results in more and more people functioning in a consultative stance. The essence of this stance is that of wanting to have influence when you do not have direct control. This challenge is true not just for consultants. It is true for people who used to be in charge: bosses, teachers, preachers, doctors, sergeants, mayors, and not least of all, parents. Permanent vulnerability and uncertainty demand a level of relatedness based on listening, authenticity, and not knowing. This is what makes command and control behavior increasingly obsolete. Not all of us get this, but sooner or later, we're going to develop our capacity for deeper relatedness and partnership, or we will be looking for a new job sooner than our careful planning might have indicated. In response to the wider need for a consultative stance, I have added in this edition two examples of how consulting skills can be useful, actually transformative, in a broader context than strictly for people in a support or consulting role. I have picked two sectors of society where the call for change and reform has been shouting in our ears for decades, with little to show for it: healthcare and education. These are also service industries, which is where most of us work these days. Both of these fields are in the throes of the language of reform. But most reform efforts are more about improvement rather than rethinking something more fundamental. The healthcare reform is mostly about cost control, who pays, and increasing the pressure on standardization. There is no reform in that conversation, just better or different management. Real reform in healthcare will come from changing our relationship with our service provider and having service providers change their relationship with each other. In consulting terms, we need more balanced contracting, more joint discovery, and a new dialogue. This is starting to occur, and Chapter 12 presents a great example from a very special surgeon, Paul Ulig. Like healthcare, the current conversation about education reform is also not reform. It is just more controls and imposed standards, masquerading as reform. True reform will shift our thinking about the culture of the classroom, accountability of the learner, and the relationship between teacher and student. An example of this from an amazing high school teacher, Ward Maillard, is in Chapter 18. Looking at the face of reform in these two arenas gives us clues on ways to achieve changes for leadership in other areas, such as business, government, religion, and human services. In addition to living with permanent uncertainty, we are living increasingly virtual lives. Many of our relationships are long distance. We are part of virtual teams spread too far to ever be in the same room together. We are more and more dependent on electronic interaction. We speak to friends by writing on an electronic wall, and we substitute webinars for seminars. Soon, we will be able to hold all our conversations, be entertained, find a life partner, and visually be with our family, all in a handheld device. Despite the growth of the virtual world, our days are still occasionally populated with live human beings, and when we are in the room with others, we need to get to the point and make the most of it. Playing roles, being vague, speaking in generalities, and getting to the point in the last 5 minutes waste the uniqueness of having all our senses available when we are face to face. We want to take advantage of real meetings to become personally connected in ways powerful enough to overcome the distancing and isolating effects inherent in an electronic connection. Thus, the need for authenticity and directness about sensitive issues outlined in this book increases. There is a discussion in Chapter 6 about ways to make virtual relationships as useful as possible. If you do not want to read that far, text me, and I will compress it and send to your Dropbox, assuming you give me the key. Another revision in this edition is in the chapters on the feedback phase and on implementation. Giving feedback is part of every consulting or support effort, but almost every meeting is one where ideas or analyses are presented with the intent of improving or shifting a person's or organization's strategy or operation. We still spend way too much time making our point, often our PowerPoint, without realizing that the purpose of most meetings is not to make a point or express ideas or to sell something, but to move something forward. That is why I have broadened the idea of a feedback meeting to include any meeting that has the intent of producing action. The action does not move forward when one person is talking and a group of people are listening. It is dialogue, interaction, doubts, and commitments that move the action forward. This sounds so simple and remains so rare that I explored in more detail in chapters 15 and 17. One other addition relates to the shift occurring in the organizational world from a primary focus on needs and efficiencies to a focus on possibilities, gifts, and strengths. The belief is that more change occurs when we focus on the future and our capacities, rather than try to make sense of the past or even the present, and look so much at problems and what is wrong. In Chapter 12, I give some examples of where this is occurring, and offer some thoughts on what this means for consulting work. The design of the book. I am somewhat neurotic about meeting rooms, how they are arranged, the light, the color, the art, the movement, all the things that bring aliveness into our experience. In the same way, I believe the design of a book is as important as its content. Ideas should be accessible and written in everyday language. The pages should invite readers in with white space, large type for aging eyes, and images, in this case drawings, to break up patterns and give the eye more places to go. Along these lines, one of my concerns about the first revision was that the book became too thick. It was heavy to hold, hard to travel with, exhausting to contemplate finishing. Worried about this, I turned to the internet to provide the vehicle to do something about it. In this edition, I have taken all the content that did not seem right to the point and moved it to the Flawless Consulting website, www.flawlessconsulting.com. Throughout the book, you will be guided to expanded content that is relevant to the material you are reading. It also gives me a way to update ideas as they evolve. I hope this works. If it doesn't work for you, or if you do not have access to the internet, let me know, and I will provide more hard copy. If enough of you want more hard copy, I've got me another book, so that's not so bad either. What is still true? What needs reaffirmation in this edition of the book is that teams and personal relationships are still critical to technical and business success. The value of teams and relationships is now more widely accepted than it was in the past, at least intellectually. We may not be any better at working together, but at least we know it matters and want to create more cooperative workplaces, whether virtual or in person. One reason the ideas in this book have endured is not so much that specific consulting skills are presented in such overconfident specificity. It is more because of the attention the book gives to the emotional and personal dimensions of our workplaces. Even now, with all the rhetoric given to relationships, personal development, and even spirituality, our institutions still operate as if strategy, structure, and technology are what really matter. Relationships continue to be treated as a necessary inconvenience, as if they have to be endured, and wherever there is an opportunity to automate a transaction or communicate electronically, we take it. In 2000, most telephone conversations involved a machine on one end. Now it is text messages, email, And if I want to look personal, Facebook, LinkedIn, and their successors. These are often the media of choice. Even more, we encourage people to work at home, where human interaction is minimized in the name of serenity and a more balanced life. What is difficult about managing relationships is that something is demanded of us that technology and automated routines do not require. The need to know ourselves and be authentic. Authenticity is simply being honest with ourselves and being direct and honest with others. For whatever the reason, authenticity continues to be rare in our workplaces. Most interactions carry an element of role play, positioning, and strategy. All are reflections of our wish to control our environment and the people in it. In some ways, this book is a long and detailed description of the landscape of authenticity. What has stood the test of time is that this rare act is not only good for the soul, but also works very well. Authentic consultant is not an oxymoron, but a compelling competitive advantage, if unfortunately a rare one. What is still difficult about authenticity is that it is a high-risk strategy. It swims upstream in a culture of control, which is where most of our organizations remain. It also demands some faith in ourselves. We have to be tuned in to the feeling dimension of our connection with others. Most of us have spent our days developing our brain and have left our body and its feeling parts behind to be reclaimed after work hours. So even when we decide to risk being authentic, we might not know how. Valuing the relationship between consultant and client, or teacher and student, or service provider and customer, and defining how to manage that relationship is where this book has found its niche. The intent of this revision is to deepen and expand that white space between strategy, structure, and technology that we label relationship. Peter Block, Cincinnati, Ohio, October 2010. Chapter 1. A Consultant by Any Other Name. The term consultant has become much maligned and in disrepute. For example, if a client asks, "What time is it?" a consultant might say, "What time do you want it to be?" Or if the client asks, "What time is it?" the consultant might say, "Give me your watch and I will tell you." And there's also the saying, "Those who can, do. Those who can't, teach or consult." Any form of humor or sarcasm has some truth in it. The truth and the prevailing skepticism about consultants is that the traditional consultant has tended to act solely as an agent of management, assuming the manager's role in either performing highly technical activities that a manager cannot do, or performing distasteful and boring activities that a manager does not want to do. The most dramatic examples of consultants taking the place of managers is when they identify people who will be let go, or functions that will be eliminated. When you are asked directions, and you tell someone to get off the bus 2 stops before you do, you are acting as a consultant. Every time you give advice to someone who is faced with a choice, you are consulting. When you don't have direct control over people, and yet want them to listen to you and heed your advice, you are face-to-face with the consultant's dilemma. For some of you, this may be your full-time predicament. Some of you may face it only occasionally, functioning part-time as managers, having direct control, and part-time as consultants, wanting to influence but lacking authority to control. Some definitions and distinctions. A consultant is a person in a position to have some influence over an individual, a group, or an organization, but has no direct power to make changes or implement programs. A manager is someone who has direct responsibility over the action. The moment you take direct responsibility, you are acting as a manager. Most people in staff or support roles in organizations are really consultants, even if they don't officially call themselves consultants. Support people function in any organization by planning, recommending, assisting, or advising in such matters as these: human resources or personnel, financial analysis, auditing, systems analysis, market research, product design, long-range planning, organizational effectiveness, safety, training and development, and many more. The recipients of all this advice are called clients. Sometimes the client is a single individual, Other times the client may be a work group, a department, or a whole organization. The client is the person or persons whom the consultant wants to influence. Note, you will mainly hear the terms consultant and client used throughout the rest of this book to reinforce this belief, and especially if you are in a staff or support role, assist your thinking of yourself as a consultant. In organizations, clients for the services provided by support people are called line managers. Line managers have to labor under the advice of support groups, whether they like it or not. But by definition, any support function has no direct authority over anything but its own time, its own internal staff, and the nature of the service it offers. This tension between the line manager, or client, who has direct control, and the support person, or consultant, who does not have direct control, is one of the central themes of this book. The key to understanding the consultant role is to see the difference between a consultant and a manager. Listen to Alfred. It was a great four-month project. I headed the team from administrative services that installed the new management information system. We assessed the problems, designed the system, and got Alice, the line manager, to let us install the system from top to bottom. Alfred is clearly very satisfied. But this is the line manager's satisfaction. He wasn't really acting as a consultant. He took over a piece of the line manager's job for 4 months. This distinction is important. A consultant needs to function differently from a line manager, for the consultant's own sake, and for the learning goals of the client. It's okay to have direct control, and most of us want it in various forms of disguise. It is essential, though, to be aware of the difference in the roles we are assuming when we have it and when we don't. Much of the disfavor associated with the term consultant comes from the actions of people who call themselves consultants, but act as surrogate line managers. When you act on behalf of or in the place of the manager, you are acting as a surrogate manager. When the client says, "Complete this report for me, hire this person for me, design this system for me, counsel this employee, or figure out which jobs stay and which jobs go," the manager is asking for a surrogate. The attraction of the surrogate manager role is that at least for that one moment, you assume the manager's power. But in fact, you are doing the manager's job, not yours. Your goal or end product in any consulting activity is some kind of change. Change comes in two varieties. At one level, we consult to create change in the line organization of a structural, policy, or procedural nature. For example, a new compensation package, a new reporting process, or a new safety program. The second kind of change is the end result that one person or many people in the line organization have learned something new. They may have learned what norms dominate their staff meetings, what they do to keep lower-level people in a highly dependent position in decision-making, how to involve people more directly in setting goals, or how to conduct better performance evaluations. In its most general use, consultation describes any action you take with a system of which you are not a part. An interview with someone asking for help is a consulting act. A survey of problems, a training program, an evaluation, a study, all are consultations for the sake of change. The consultant's objective is to engage in successful actions that result in people or organizations managing themselves differently. I think of the term staff or support work and consulting work as being interchangeable, reflecting my belief that people in a support role need consulting skills to be effective, regardless of their field of technical expertise, finance, planning, engineering, personnel, systems, law. Every time you give advice to someone who is in the position to make the choice, you are consulting. For each of these moments of consultation, there are three kinds of skills you need to do a good job: technical, interpersonal, and consulting skills. Here are the distinctions. Technical skills. Above all, we need to know what the person is talking about. We need expertise about the question. Either in college or in our first job, we were trained in a specific field or function. This might be engineering, sales, accounting, counseling, or any of the thousands of other ways people make a living. This is our basic training. It is only later, after acquiring some technical expertise, that we start consulting. If we didn't have some expertise, then people wouldn't ask for our advice. The foundation for consulting skills is some expertise, whether it is scientific, such as Koch particle sizing, or non-scientific, such as management or organizational development. This book assumes you have some area of expertise. Interpersonal skills. To function with people, we need to have some interpersonal skills. That is, some ability to put ideas into words, to listen, to give support, to disagree reasonably, to basically maintain a relationship. There are many books and seminars available to help people with these skills. In fact, there is a whole industry about achieving better relationships that is devoted to improving these skills. Just like technical skills, interpersonal skills are necessary to effective consultation. Consulting skills. Each consulting project, whether it lasts 10 minutes or 10 months, goes through 5 phases. The steps in each phase are sequential. If you skip one, or assume it has been taken care of, you are headed for trouble. Skillful consulting is being competent in the execution of each of these steps. Successfully completing the business of each phase is the primary focus of this book. Consulting Skills Preview. Here is an overview of what is involved in the 5 phases of consulting. Phase 1, Entry and Contracting. This phase has to do with the initial contact with a client about the project. It includes setting up the first meeting, as well as exploring the problem, whether the consultant is the right person to work on this issue, what the client's expectations are, what the consultant's expectations are, and how to get started. When consultants talk about their disasters, their conclusion is usually that the project was faulty in the initial contracting stage. Phase 2, Discovery and Dialogue. Consultants need to come up with their own sense of both the problem and the strengths the client has. This may be the most useful thing they do. They also need skill in helping the client do the same. The questions here for the consultant are, who is going to be involved in defining the problem or situation? What methods will be used? What kind of data should be collected? How long will it take? Should the inquiry be done by the consultant, or should it be done by the client? Phase 3, Analysis and the Decision to Act. The inquiry and dialogue must be organized and reported in some fashion. The consultant is always in the position of reducing large amounts of data to a manageable number of issues. There are also choices for the consultant to make on how to involve the client in the process of analyzing the information. In giving feedback to an organization, there is always some resistance to the data, if it deals with important issues. The consultant must handle this resistance before an appropriate decision can be made about how to proceed. This phase is really what many people call planning. It includes setting ultimate goals for the project and selecting the best action steps or changes. Phase 4, Engagement and Implementation. This involves carrying out the planning of Phase 3. In many cases, the implementation may fall entirely on the line organization. For larger change efforts, the consultant may be deeply involved. Some projects start implementation with an educational event. This could be a series of meetings to introduce some change, a single meeting to get different parts of the organization together to address a problem, or a training session. In these cases, the consultant is usually involved in rather complicated design work and in running the meeting or training session. Phase 5, Extension, Recycle, or Termination. Phase 5 is about learning from the engagement. Following this is the decision whether to extend the process to a larger segment of the organization. Sometimes it is not until after some implementation occurs that a clear picture of the real problem emerges. In this case, the process recycles, and a new contract needs to be discussed. If the implementation was either a huge success or a moderate to high failure, termination of further involvement on this project may be in the offing. There are many options for ending the relationship, and termination should be considered a legitimate and important part of the consultation. If done well, it can provide an important learning experience for the client and the consultant, and also keep the door open for future work with the organization. Many skills and topics will be covered for the preliminary events leading to engagement and implementation. In addition, consulting skills are grouped into 4 phases: contracting, discovery, feedback, and decision. They include the initial contacts, the planning meetings, the inquiry and analysis, and the feedback and decision-making meetings. Engagement implementation is when you finally do something with enough impact to be noticeable to many people in the organization, and they have the expectation that change or learning will occur because of that event. One of my beliefs is that the preliminary events are in many ways more crucial for success than the engagement. An understanding of consulting skills, therefore, is really an understanding of preliminary events. The promise of flawless consultation. One reason consulting can be frustrating is that you are continually managing lateral relationships. As a support person or consultant, you are working with a line manager in a context in which there is no clear boss-subordinate relationship between you. Vertical relationships are easier to understand. If your boss gives you an order, you know that he or she has the right to tell you what to do. But if your client makes a demand, you don't necessarily have to obey. The power balance in lateral relationships is always open to ambiguity and to negotiation. When we get resistance from a client, sometimes we aren't sure whether to push harder or let go. This book is about managing this ambiguity. Taken as a whole, this book is about flawless consultation, consulting without error. It concentrates on the preliminary events because I believe competence in contracting, discovery, and feedback creates the foundation for successful outcomes in the implementation stage. I have deliberately avoided discussing and demonstrating consulting skills in an overall stepwise sequence of chapters, because some concepts and competencies must be brought to bear in every stage of a consulting relationship. So I have included chapters treating consulting assumptions, goals for a consulting relationship, and consultant role choices, as well as what flawless consultation means in practice, along with chapters that specify and illustrate the skills required for each of the preliminary events. I have also interspersed chapters on such issues as client resistance and the special considerations of the internal consultant's role to demonstrate the belief that successful consulting demands more than a methodical, step-by-step application of technical expertise. The promise is that if you consult in the way this book describes, your consultation can be flawless, and you will have your expertise better used, have your recommendations more frequently implemented, work in more of a partnership role with clients, avoid no-win consulting situations, develop internal commitment in your clients, receive support from your clients, increase the leverage you have with clients, establish more trusting relationships with clients. My use of the term flawless consulting may sound presumptuous, but it is not accidental. A basic value underlying this book is that there is in each of us the possibility of perfection. There is a consulting professional inside each of us, and our task is to allow that flawless consultant to emerge. On its surface, this book is about methods and techniques, but each technique carries a consistent message, more important than any method, that each act that expresses trust in ourselves and belief in the validity of our own experience is always the right path to follow. Each act that is manipulative or filled with pretense is always self-destructive. Working in organizations means we are constantly bombarded by pressure to be clever and indirect and to ignore what we are feeling at the moment. Flawless consulting offers the possibility of letting our behavior be consistent with our beliefs and feelings, and also to be successful in working with our clients. The focus in this book on techniques and skills in consulting is simply a way to identify the high self-trust choices we all have as we work in organizations. From the first day on our first job, each of us has struggled with a conflict between being ourselves and conforming to the expectations we think our employers or clients have of us. The desire to be successful can lead us into playing roles and adopting behaviors that are internally alien and represent some loss of ourselves. Consultants are especially vulnerable to this conflict because we are supposed to be serving our clients' needs. Our projects also tend to be short-term, and we work at the pleasure of the client. It is easier to terminate a consultant or support person than to terminate a subordinate. In hard times, managers end consulting projects before they reduce their own workforce. This sense of vulnerability can become a rationalization for consultants to deny their own needs and feelings, and to not be authentic. This book offers an alternative. It says that trusting ourselves is the path that serves us well with clients, and increases the chances that our expertise will be used again and again. Chapter 2. Techniques are not enough. There are dimensions to the consulting role that transcend any specific methods we might employ and contribute to our effectiveness no matter what our technical expertise. A unique and beguiling aspect of doing consulting is that your own self is involved in the process to a much greater extent than if you were applying your expertise in some other way. Your reactions to a client, your feelings during discussions, your ability to solicit feedback from the client, all are important dimensions to consultation. In acting as a consultant, you always operate at two levels. One level is the content, the cognitive part of a discussion between yourself and the client. The client presents a certain organizational problem. Perhaps it's the need for training to improve workforce skills. Perhaps it's how the organization makes decisions. Or there may be a problem of system design or financial controls. The content level is the analytical, rational, or explicit part of the discussion, where you are working on what can be called the technical or business situation. At the same time, and at another level, both you and the client are generating and sensing your feelings about each other, whether you feel acceptance or resistance, whether you feel high or low tension, whether you feel support or confrontation. So your relationship to the client during each phase is a second level of data that needs attention, just as the content does. Beyond content, there is much more to the client-consultant relationship than the simple content of the problem or project the consultant is working on. Feelings are the affective side of the discussion, and an important source of information for the consultant. Information about the client's real concerns, and what the possibilities are for establishing a good relationship. A major objective of every consultation is to encourage you to focus on and value the affective or interpersonal aspect of the relationship you have with the client. Most of us have a great deal of experience working at the cognitive or content level of discussion. We come to a meeting equipped with our expertise, and we feel quite comfortable talking about problems we know something about. But there should be equal balance in the attention given to the content of the problem and the feelings you are having about the interaction that is taking place as you are working with the client. Once you value the affective side of the relationship as an important area of attention, the second step is to increase your comfort level in putting into words how you are feeling about the relationship as it's going on. The third step is to grow more skillful in putting your sense of the relationship into words, so you don't increase defensiveness on the part of the client. There are four elements to the affective side of consultant-client interaction that are always operating: responsibility, feelings, trust, and your own needs. Responsibility. To have a good contract with a client, responsibility for what is planned and takes place has to be balanced, 50-50. In most cases, the client comes to you with the expectation that once you are told what the problem is, you provide the solution. Your goal is to act out the fact that it's a 50-50 proposition. Here is a small example. When you start a program, communication on the program is often required. When it will take place, what the arrangements are, why you're doing it. It's important that the client take the responsibility of communicating all of this to the organization, not because it's a task that only the client can do. In fact, the consultant might be in a better position to do it. But because it's a way of visibly expressing to the organization that the client is taking at least 50% of the responsibility for the program. If the client wants the consultant to do this communicating and take care of all the administrative details, the client is saying that he or she wants to take a limited amount of responsibility. As a consultant, it makes sense at times to resist taking on this responsibility. This is a substantively small issue, but it's an example of what to look for in trying to decide in your own mind whether the responsibility is balanced. Feelings. The second element that's always an issue is to what extent clients are able to own their own feelings. In a way, this is working on balancing responsibility. The consultant needs to constantly keep in mind how much the client is owning feelings versus talking as if he or she is just an observer of the organization. The consultant also has to keep in mind what his or her own feelings are about the client. If the consultant is feeling that the client is defensive or very controlling, or doesn't listen or doesn't take responsibility, this is important to know. However the consultant feels working with that client, the people inside the client's organization are going to feel the same way.
It is equally important for you to pay close attention to your own feelings during the consultation, particularly during the early stages, and use these as valuable information on how the organization functions and how the client manages. Trust. The third element is trust. When most people work with a consultant as a client, they bring with them not only the prevailing image of the consultant as the expert, but also someone to watch out for. It is often useful to ask clients whether they trust your confidentiality, whether they trust you not to make them vulnerable or to take things over. You can ask them what doubts they have working with you. In this way, you are working to build trust. The more that any distrust is put into words, the more likely you are to build trust. Your own needs. The fourth element on the affective side of the consultant-client relationship is that consultants have a right to their own needs from the relationship. It's easy to fall into a service mentality, in which you see yourself charged with solving the client's problems and serving the client's needs. And it's possible to act in such a way that you, as the consultant, appear not to have any needs. The reality is that you do have needs. You may have organizational needs to have a client, so that your own organization feels that you're doing something worthwhile. You have needs for acceptance and inclusion by the client, and you require some validation that what you have is valuable and worth offering. On a practical level, you have needs for access to that organization, to talk to people, to ask them questions. And you also have needs for support from the manager, meeting the people in the manager's organization, and dealing with the kind of resistance that you're likely to get. You are entitled to have your needs met. Summing up, the beliefs outlined here are the foundation for the rest of this book. Pay close attention to your own style and your own feelings as important dimensions to the consulting relationship. Skill in consulting is not only skill in providing a program, a process, and procedures that respond to the client's needs. It's also your skill in being able to identify and put into words the issues around trust, feelings, responsibility, and your own needs. The consultant's assumptions. Any view of what makes for effective consultation relies heavily on the assumptions the consultant has about what makes an effective organization. These assumptions will be implicitly or explicitly a part of any recommendation the consultant makes. Each of us doing consulting ought to be very clear about our own beliefs. Our own consulting behavior should be consistent with the style of management we advocate to our clients. If we are recommending to our clients that they tighten up controls, be more decisive, and set clear goals, we will be undermining our credibility if we ourselves operate without controls, are indecisive, and aren't quite sure where we are headed. If we think our clients should work on being more participative and collaborative, we undermine ourselves if we keep tight control of the consulting project and don't act collaboratively with the very clients we are trying to encourage to try collaboration. Think about what your assumptions about good management might be. There are countless models to choose from. Most organizations, for example, operate from a variation of the traditional military church model of patriarchy. Structurally, there is a great emphasis on the hierarchical pyramid and the clear separation of authority and responsibility. The cornerstone of patriarchal management is strong leadership. This kind of leadership is seen as an individual ability to plan work, organize people to do the work, maintain control of those people and their results, and then delegate responsibility to the right people to achieve results. The products of these leader-centered assumptions are individuals with an upward-conforming and downward-controlling orientation toward their roles. This traditional emphasis on control and leadership qualities has shifted in the past 30 years, at least in the literature, to more collaborative or participative conceptions of organizations. Participative management and empowerment is a theme that runs throughout most assumptions about effective organizations today. Your own assumptions about organizations determine in subtle ways your own consulting style and the skills you should be working on. Here is the set of assumptions that underlie the consulting approach presented in this book. Problem solving requires valid data. Using valid data eliminates a major cause of confusion, uncertainty, and resulting inefficiency in problem solving. Valid data encompass two things. One, objective data about ideas, events, or situations that everyone accepts as facts. And two, personal data. Personal data are also facts, but they concern how individuals feel about what is happening to them and around them. If people feel they will not get a fair shake, it is a fact that they feel that way, and it is also a fact that this belief will have an effect on their behavior. To ignore this kind of fact is to throw away data that may be crucial to any problem-solving effort. Effective decision-making requires free and open choice. Making decisions is easy. Making decisions that people will support is not so easy. Organizations seem to work better when people have an opportunity to influence decisions that have a direct impact on their work. When people feel that something is important and they have some control, they will be motivated to exert the effort to make things work. When they believe that something is important, but they can exert no control, the common tendencies are to become cautious or defensive, play it safe, withhold information, protect themselves from blame. Effective implementation requires internal commitment. People readily commit themselves to things they believe will further their interests. If they see no link between what they're asked to do and what they want to do, the probability of getting an all-out effort from them is not likely. You can order people to do things, and ordinarily they will comply, at least while you are watching. But if you want them to apply themselves, their internal commitment is required. The consultant's goals. Our assumptions about what contributes to effective consultant and manager performance lead to a set of preferred goals for each consulting job. Achieving each of these goals may not always be possible, but we can always be clear about our preference. Goal 1. Establish a collaborative relationship. There are two reasons for consultants to strive for collaborative relationships with their clients. One is that a collaborative relationship promises maximum use of people's resources, both the consultants and the clients. It also spreads the responsibility for success or failure and for implementation, and it's a nice way to work, too. The second reason is that whether they know it or not, consultants are always functioning as models of how to solve problems. The message contained in the way consultants act is much more powerful than their words. To talk collaboration and behave differently is confusing and self-defeating. Goal 2. Solve problems so they stay solved. It is possible to act in such a way that only the immediate problem gets solved. If the problem is that employees regularly come late to work, for example, actions can be taken to prevent it. Station the boss at the door in the morning with a pencil and a black book, or have room checks at starting time each morning, or issue a policy statement about lateness, or have meetings with employees about the need for punctuality. These actions might reduce the problem of lateness. And if internal or external consultants have been involved in making these kinds of recommendations, they might have contributed to an increase in the effectiveness of the organization. But this does not mean that the managers have learned anything about how to solve similar problems and thus become more competent. The consultant's alternative is to work with line managers at another level of analysis, the way they handle lateness problems. For example, managers may not see lateness as being a symptom of discontent, or a symptom of inexperienced supervision at the first level, or any of the other possible root problems lateness could be signaling. Also, it is possible the consultant is being asked to solve problems that line managers should be confronting themselves. Teaching managers the skills for solving a problem themselves next time requires that they understand that disturbing employee behavior is a symptom of more basic problems and that they should not ask others to address problems that belong to them. Goal 3. Ensure attention is given to both the technical business problem and the relationships. Each situation has two elements: the technical business problem that has to be resolved, and the way people are interacting around that problem. In most organizations, primary attention is given to the technical business problem. Consultants, however, are in a unique position to address the people or process issues productively. As third parties, they have no vested interest in the process issues, no power to gain or lose, no territory to expand or contract, no budget to increase or decrease. Consultants can urge attention to the process issues, and line managers will listen to them in a way in which they would not listen to each other. Developing client commitment, a secondary goal of each consulting act. Because consultants or support people have no direct control over implementation, they become dependent on line managers for producing results. It is the line manager who ultimately will decide whether to take action, and this choice will be based on how internally committed he or she is to the concepts the consultant is suggesting. Therefore, the consultant needs to be conscious of building internal commitment throughout the consulting process. Effective consulting skills are the steps and behaviors that act to create internal commitment in managers. Each of us has seen examples of consulting projects where the study report ends up on a shelf, despite its cost and relevance. When this happens, it often means that somewhere along the line, the consulting process lost the managers who had to decide to use the results of the study. In flawless consulting, you move through the steps of a consulting process designed to build commitment and reduce the chance of losing the client along the way. Client commitment is the key to consultant leverage and impact. We can't order the client to take action. Sometimes we decide to go to the client's boss and urge him or her to direct the client to use our recommendations. But this is a risky proposition, particularly if we want to stay in the good graces of our client. So our impact is determined by the client's commitment to our suggestions. Building this commitment is often a process of removing obstacles that block the client from acting on our advice. We may cling to the fantasy that if our thinking is clear and logical, our wording eloquent, and our conviction solid, the strength of our arguments will carry the day. And make no mistake, clear arguments do help, but they are not enough. The client and his or her colleagues will experience doubts and dilemmas that will block commitment. Roles consultants choose. Having leverage requires confronting the doubts at each stage of the consulting process, during contracting, discovery, analysis, and while preparing for the feedback meeting. Waiting until the implementation phase to overcome resistance is too late. Ed Schein has identified three ways consultants work with line managers: in an expert role, a pair of hands role, or a collaborative role. The choice depends on individual differences in management style, the nature of the task, and the consultant's own personal preference. Note, these roles were first formulated by Ed Schein in the 1960s. He was one of the first to see the limitations of the expert role for consultants and to find and open the door to the collaborative potential in the helping process. His book, Process Consulting Revisited, Building the Helping Relationship, Reading, Massachusetts, Addison Wesley Longman, 1998, more fully describes the power of process consultation as a vital capacity for those in a helping position. It is a book I strongly recommend. As you consult in a variety of situations, it helps to become aware of the role you typically assume and to be able to identify situations where this will help or hinder your performance. Only then can you make a conscious choice among alternatives. One discovery that people often make in such self-analysis is that they begin to identify situations where they can operate more successfully in a collaborative mode. However, the realities of most organizations are such that there will be times when the pair of hands or expert roles are more appropriate, and other times when they cannot be avoided. Expert role. One way line managers typically relate to support specialists, as well as to external consultants, is client to expert. The support person becomes the expert in the performance of a given task. For example, an organization's new corporate benefits website recently was completely overhauled, and it has become clear that the site has not lived up to expectations. The overall design is okay. The problem is somewhere in the navigation and the non-intuitive way employees have to input information to the site. At this point, the manager calls in a staff website design specialist, describes the difficulties, and says to the designer, "I have neither the time nor the inclination to deal with this problem. You're the expert. Find out what's wrong and fix it. You have a free hand to examine the whole system and do whatever analysis and fixing is necessary. Keep me posted on your findings and what you intend to do." The website designer becomes, in effect, a member of the manager's staff, with delegated authority to plan and implement a program of change, subject to the same restrictions as other members of the manager's staff. Here is what is happening in this kind of relationship. The manager has elected to play an inactive role. He or she expects to hold the consultant, that is, the website designer, responsible for results. The designer as consultant accepts the responsibility and feels free to develop and implement action plans. The manager is expected to be responsive and provide the assistance needed to solve the problem. Decisions on how to proceed are made by the consultant on the basis of his or her expert judgment. There is no need to involve the manager in technical details. The consultant gathers the information needed for problem analysis and decides what methods of data collection and analysis to use. Technical control rests with the consultant. Disagreement is not likely, because it would be difficult for the manager to challenge expert reasoning. If the manager seeks to exert control over technical decisions, the consultant will see it as unjustified interference. In this situation, collaboration is not required, because the problem-solving efforts are based on specialized procedures. Two-way communication here is limited. The consultant initiates and the client responds. The consultant expects and is expected to initiate communication in a question and answer mode. The consultant plans and carries out the engagement or implementation, or provides detailed instructions for implementation by the manager, whose role is to judge and evaluate after the fact. The consultant's goal in this example is to solve the immediate problem. Neither the manager nor the consultant expects the manager to develop skills to solve similar problems in the future. Problems. Internal consultants especially are well aware of the problems involved in operating in the role of expert. Here are two big ones. First, consider the consultant's ability to make an accurate assessment. Given a problem of a purely technical nature, the consultant can use technical expertise to isolate the problem and develop a solution. But problems that are purely technical are rare. Most problems have a human element in them, and if the prevailing organizational climate is fear, insecurity, or mistrust, people may withhold or distort essential information on the human part of the problem. Without valid data, accurate assessment becomes impossible. Action programs based on faulty discovery have little chance for success. Second, consider the commitment of people to take the recommended actions. Studies done by outside experts seldom carry the kind of personal ownership and commitment needed to deal with difficult management issues. Pair of hands role. Here, the manager sees the consultant as an extra pair of hands. The manager says, in effect, "I have neither the time nor the inclination to deal with this problem. I have examined the deficiencies and have prepared an outline of what needs to be done. I want you to get it done as soon as possible." The manager retains full control. The consultant is expected to apply specialized knowledge to implement action plans toward the achievement of goals that the manager has defined. Here are some of the clues that the consultant is acting as a pair of hands. The consultant takes a passive role. The order of the day is responding to the manager's requests, and the consultant does not question the manager's action plans. The manager makes the decisions on how to proceed. The consultant may prepare recommendations for the manager's review, but approval rests with the manager. The manager selects the methods for discovery and analysis. The consultant may do the actual data collection, but only in accordance with procedures that the manager has outlined. Control rests with the manager. The consultant is expected to make suggestions, but avoids disagreement because the manager would see this as a challenge to his or her authority. Collaboration is not really necessary. The manager feels that it is his or her responsibility to specify goals and procedures. The consultant can ask questions for clarification. Two-way communication is limited. The manager initiates and the consultant responds. The manager initiates in a descriptive or evaluative mode. The manager specifies change procedures for the consultant to implement. The manager's role is to judge and evaluate from a close distance. The consultant's goal is to make the system more effective by the application of specialized knowledge. Problems. The major problem emerges in the discovery phase. In a pair of hands role, the consultant is dependent on the manager's ability to understand what is happening and to develop an effective action plan. If the manager's assessment is faulty, the action plan won't work, and the consultant who provided the service becomes a convenient scapegoat. To avoid this trap, the consultant may ask for time to verify the manager's assessment. And then the consultant might face another problem. Managers who have a preference for consultants who take on the pair of hands role may interpret such requests as questioning their experience, their authority, or both. Collaborative role. the consultant who assumes a collaborative role enters the relationship with the notion that management issues can be dealt with effectively only by joining his or her specialized knowledge with a manager's knowledge of the organization. Problem solving becomes a joint undertaking, with equal attention to both the technical issues and the human interactions in dealing with the technical issues. When consultants work through a collaborative role, they don't solve problems for the manager. They apply their special skills to help managers solve problems themselves. The distinction is significant. The key assumption underlying the collaborative role is that the manager must be actively involved in data gathering and analysis, setting goals and developing action plans, and finally, sharing responsibility for success or failure. Here's what happens. The consultant and the manager work to become interdependent. They share responsibility for action planning, implementation, and results. Decision-making is bilateral. It is characterized by mutual exchange and respect for the responsibilities and expertise of both parties. Data collection and analysis are joint efforts. The selection of the discovery process to be used is done by both the consultant and the manager. Control issues become matters for discussion and negotiation. Disagreement is expected and seen as a source of new ideas. Collaboration is considered essential. The consultant makes a special point to reach understanding and agreement on the nature and scope of mutual expectations prior to initiating problem-solving efforts. Communication is two-way. Both the consultant and the manager take the initiative, depending on the issues. Information exchange is carried on in a problem-solving mode. Implementation responsibilities are determined by discussion and agreement. Assignments are made to maximize use of the available resources, in line with the responsibilities appropriate to each party. The goal is to solve problems so they stay solved. That is, the consultant establishes a helping relationship designed to broaden the competence level of managers to develop and implement action plans that will make the system more effective. The next time a similar problem arises, the manager will have the skills to solve it. Problems. There are also problems in trying to work collaboratively. Consultants often have special skills, for example, in information technology or budget management, that managers see as a quick answer to their problems. Managers who prefer to work with consultants in an expert role may interpret any attempts at collaboration as indifference or foot dragging. Managers with a preference for working with consultants in a pair of hands role may interpret moves toward collaboration as insubordination. Plus, working collaboratively takes some time. Collaboration and the fear of holding hands. In a presentation on collaborative consultation, a person in the audience kept asking questions about the nature of collaboration. Can't it be a sign of weakness? Don't you have expertise that you are denying if you operate too collaboratively? Clients want answers, not questions, don't they? Finally, with a lot of frustration, he said, "Well, I don't want my consultants just sitting around holding hands with the client." He was pointing to an area where there is considerable confusion about the distinction between the expert role and the collaborative role. The core transaction of any consulting contract is the transfer of expertise from the consultant to the client. This holds whether the expertise is very tangible, such as skill in circuit design or systems design, or whether the expertise is very intangible, such as problem-solving or team-building skill. Whatever the expertise, it is the basis for the consultants being in business. Part of the fear of holding hands seems to be that if you get too intertwined with the client, your expertise will somehow be diluted and blurred. A collaborative approach can come across as implying that the consultant and the client have equal expertise and are partners in technical matters. This might force the consultant to unconsciously underplay his or her own expertise in order to maintain a 50-50 relationship. If this were to happen, the fear of diluting expertise would become a reality. One consultant expressed this fear and confusion by saying, "I've forgotten more about managing inventories than most of my clients will ever know. They can hardly spell the word, and I'm the corporate guru. How can I be collaborative under those conditions?" The confusion is between collaborating on the technical aspects of the problem, which I don't mean, and collaborating on how the stages of the consultation will be carried out, which I do mean. Here's an example of where you draw the line between them. Areas of collaboration. expressing the wants of the client, planning how to inform the organization of the study, deciding who is involved in the discovery phase, generating the right kind of data, interpreting the results of discovery, deciding how to make a change. Areas of expertise: circuit design, training design, questionnaire design, package design, systems analysis, pricing strategy. Regardless of the area of expertise, the way the consultation process itself is managed will greatly affect the client's use of even the most technical expertise. The more the consultative process can be collaborative, the better the odds for success are after the consultant has left.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.